A very good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee. There are no apologies this morning, and our first item is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. So the committee will now consider an affirmative statutory instrument, the Advice and Assistance Summary Criminal Proceedings, Miscellaneous Amendment, Scotland Regulations of 2022, and I refer members to Paper 1. This SSI makes amendments to the current Advice and Assistance Regulations to support a Sheriff Court initiative that seeks to encourage appropriate early resolution of summary cases. And I welcome Ash Regan, Minister for Community Safety, and her officials to this morning's meeting. Welcome. So I now invite the Minister to make a short statement on the SSI. Minister.
Good morning, Convener and Committee. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to the Committee about the Advice and Assistance Summary Criminal Proceedings Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations of 2022. So these regulations have been brought forward to support the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service evidence and procedure review, through which three sheriff courts will pilot an initiative to test the benefits of earlier engagement between the Procurator Fiscal Service and defence agents. And the purpose of the pilot is to encourage appropriate early resolution of summary criminal cases. And facilitating such appropriate early resolution will both benefit an accused person and reduce the volume of cases within our courts, aiding the overall efficiency of the justice system. Remuneration of the legal professionals involved also has to play a part in achieving these benefits. Currently, more favourable fee arrangements are available when a pleading diet has taken place in a case, which may act as a disincentive to earlier resolution. And two situations have been identified where a case may resolve without proceeding as far as the pleading diet and so give rise to less favourable fee consequences. So one situation is in cases that involve the service of a complaint, but which are susceptible to resolution should the Procurator Fiscal Service agree to drop the case and not call it. And secondly, there are cases that involve disclosure and or Crown or defence engagement prior to the date a complaint is actually served, such as undertaking cases. And again, they may resolve in a way that allows the Procurator Fiscal Service to again drop the case. So the provisions in this instrument will amend legal aid fee arrangements to allow an inclusive fee to be paid to defence agents at an earlier stage of proceedings, having regard to both of those scenarios, and a pleading diet will no longer be required to trigger payment of the inclusive fee. So that gives a brief overview for the committee on the regulations, and happy to answer any further questions the committee may have.
Thanks very much, Minister, for that. So I'll now just open up to members. If you'd like to ask any questions, please just indicate.
Jamie. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, colleagues. So I just had a couple of quick questions. I appreciate that the SSI before us is specifically around the payment of legal aid fees and the consequence of the pilots that I might have on that. But I wanted to ask more widely about the pilot itself. Would it be fair to say that the purpose of the pilot is to... Or one potential outcome would be to reduce the number of cases that proceed to a trial diet. And can I ask what the benefits or indeed perhaps the consequences of that might be? And I suppose I ask because on the face of it might appear that that may encourage lawyers to sit in a smoke-filled room and do deals together rather than people feel like their cases should proceed to what normally would happen to a trial. Is it the case that we may see an increase in the number of deals being done where there already is perhaps a sense of a feeling of a lack of transparency around what is discussed in those private meetings and, of course, the outcomes that are delivered where we've already heard numerous concerns as a committee from victims and victims' organisations about the consequences of not being kept in the loop around deals such as this. And I just wondered what the government's thoughts were about the pilots and how they would be received.
So I think the first thing to be clear about is that this is work that's been carried out by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. So this is part of their evidence and procedure review. So this is something that they're working on themselves to encourage appropriate early resolution of summary criminal cases. And in doing so, you rightly, as you rightly point out, that may reduce the number of summary criminal cases that are going into the court system. But I would stress that we feel that this would only be for cases where that is appropriate. So that's the first thing to make clear. So the pilots will be taking place in Dundee, Hamilton and Paisley. They've already started. So they started on the 5th of September. And these are obviously an attempt to look at ways that things can be improved, that efficiency can be improved. And I think that that will bring benefits to right across the whole system. I think it will benefit the accused, and I also am quite clear, I think it will bring benefits to victims as well as the court system itself. So what they're looking at within this pilot is to resolve cases at the earliest opportunity without the need for the trial to be fixed, to reduce the need for full disclosure where cases can be resolved, reduce the number of cases that are called for trial, and to reduce the number of witnesses that are unnecessarily called, and preserve trials for cases that cannot easily be resolved by other means. So, as I said, I think there are benefits involved in this. And I think specifically with regard to the regulations that are in front of you, I would see them as perhaps removing a barrier that exists within the system. So I think maybe an appropriate way to describe it as many of these cases would have gone on to court when perhaps with the right fee arrangements, perhaps it would be more appropriate for them to have been resolved at an earlier stage. So I hope that answers the member's question.
Thank you. It partially does. And I do sort of read between the lines in terms of what you're saying around the current arrangements and why it may not necessarily benefit both parties to resolve cases in this way rather than in a traditional fashion. But I guess it still raises a slight flag in that who this benefits most. I think you used the phrase, this benefits the accused. I mean, surely we shouldn't be making any changes to the system which benefit anyone. The system should be fair and transparent as appropriate. I wondered what parameters would be around what types of cases it would be appropriate for this this way of dealing with them. If we're moving in that direction, would certain types of cases be excluded, for example? Who would make that decision around whether a case could be resolved in this more informal setting? And I also note in the policy notes that no public consultation was carried out, which it says due to the technical nature of the regulations, but I would say this is not just a technical move, it's quite a substantial shift in how we try and clear the backlog of cases by dealing with them in a more efficiently but perhaps less public way. So I wondered if you could comment on that as well.
Okay. So again, just to be clear, the pilot and the improvements, if you like, to the processes that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service are carrying out. That is work that they're undertaking by themselves, although obviously the Scottish Government is supportive of moves to make the system more efficient. These regulations were shared with the Law Society of Scotland and no comments were received on them. I did say that I believed that this change will benefit the accused, but not solely the accused. I think we need to be clear on that. And I did say I think it would bring benefits to victims. I also think it would be beneficial to legal practitioners as well as efficiencies right across the whole system. Obviously, we are in a position right now where in some cases there is a backlog that we need to resolve. I anticipate that changes of this nature will lead to less cases going to court, which obviously will have a beneficial effect on the number of cases that are going through, which I think is something that we're all interested in seeing. Martin, were you able to give a little bit more information for Mr. Green about the... Obviously, I set out in my statement the type of cases that it would apply to, but perhaps Martin can give a little bit more information on that.
Yeah, it's limited to summary criminal business, sheriff court cases. And I understand the pilots are overseen by the sheriffs. It's a case management system, essentially, to ensure that cases proceed in the most effective way. And what this does is remove one potential barrier to that. If everything else the SCTS is doing to improve that was in place, but this wasn't, then cases might still proceed to the trial diet, even though otherwise they would have been able to be settled. So this feeds into those processes.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Katie Clark and then Pauline.
Thank you very much. And I welcome this pilot. And I think the Minister is correct to identify that funding arrangements can affect how work is done and cases are prepared. It would be very helpful if a full and detailed report could be provided on the pilot once it's concluded to committee members. And perhaps that's something the Minister could take away so we can understand what happens and what implications that might have. In terms of the regulations themselves, I was going to ask whether you'd consulted with the Law Society or representatives of criminal defence agents, and you clearly already have had a level of engagement, although there's not been a great deal of feedback. Will you ensure that you do, obtain detailed feedback as the pilot proceeds and indeed as these regulations are rolled out, to ensure that the feedback from that side of the profession is captured, given all the concerns that have been raised about the problems in the funding of criminal defence work, given cuts in legal aid over a considerable period of time?
Well, I don't accept all of the characterisation that the member has put forward as part of that question. We have obviously shared the regulations, and as you rightly say, we haven't received a great amount of comment on them. I also want to be clear again that the pilots are not being run by the Scottish Government. It's not a Scottish Government initiative. We're not controlling it. We're not directing it. So I think if the committee are interested in a report on how the pilot is being run and the conclusions of it, I think that's probably something that the committee could take up with SCTS directly. I'm sure they would be happy to facilitate that. And also just to be clear that although the pilots are only taking place in three areas, this is an attempt to obviously support the direction that the pilots are going in and to make sure that the legal practitioners, that barrier to resolution in appropriate cases at an earlier stage isn't there in terms of the fee structure. So this will allow for earlier payment for the legal practitioners. So I hope that will be welcomed. And also that it doesn't just apply to the three areas. These regulations that are in front of the committee today will apply right across Scotland.
Thank you very much. Pauline McNeill, I think you were wanting to come in.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Yeah, I do welcome these important regulations. I think some members of this committee had actually questioned the Legal Aid Board on behalf of practitioners about the fact that there was a disincentive to actually settle cases early. And so I'm quite clear in my own mind, this is helpful for on every level. So I do support these regulations. Given what you said to Katie Clark, this is a matter for the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service, then what's the government's role in it if we've been asked to consider it? And who then determines what you would expect to see in a pilot? You know, how you measure its success? Will that be the government or will it be the Scottish Court and Tribunal Service? And I just therefore need clarification then, if it's all a matter for the Scottish Court and Tribunal Service, well, what's our role in this to pass them today?
So yes, this is being run by Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. It's part of their ongoing, I guess, work in order to improve efficiencies in the system for everyone. I'll let perhaps Justin maybe give a little bit more detail on how that's working. But in terms of the role for government, that would be in terms of supporting the work that they're doing legislatively. So this is an example of that we are, through these regulations, removing that barrier that, as the member has characterised, may create a disincentive to appropriate early settlement. And so we are changing the law to obviously to support that work. Justin, did you have anything further to add on the SCTS pilot and how they're going to be perhaps measuring it, etc.?
No, I don't have any specific information on that, but I would expect, and I'm conjecturing here, that we should be able to show through the case flows, and we can tell in terms of the, you know, through the legal aid and board data when cases settle and such like. So we there should be a demonstrable effect.
Thank you very much.
Russell, would you like to come in?
Yes, please. Good morning. Just wondering what the inclusive fee is going to be.
Yep, so it's £550.
Right, OK. And how does that differ to what the current system is?
So if the case progressed, it was the £550 fee. That fee is now going to be payable at an earlier date. I think from what the conversations, my understanding is that there wasn't a set fee before that, so it depends on the type of case and what stage it was at, but I'll let Martin give you a little bit more detail on that if you can.
Yeah, it depends at what stage things settle earlier. There's fixed payments and fee tables, you know, that apply to a case that settled in an earlier stage or where work was done prior to that. My understanding is that generally cases would proceed to the diet, and the concern is that they didn't need to proceed to the diet. So I'm not sure we have. It's not very easy to specify in the abstract what the fees would be, because it would vary in each case. But they would be less than they will be, you know, at if they settled at the diet. The change, I think, ensures that where the same work is being done except for the diet itself, in terms of the actual turning up and putting forward the accused person's position, that the bulk of that work is done anyway, and therefore the need for the diet is really only there as a procedural step that's in place, and there's not any, or at least the feeling is there's no need to keep that procedural step in place. So I think the fees will probably be the same, but the diet will no longer need to take place to allow to trigger that payment, as it were.
Okay, thank you. I mean, churn has been a huge problem in the Sheriff Courts for decades, and I guess this is what we're talking about. Is there not a risk, though, that in financially incentivising a defence lawyer to get their client, persuade their client, recommend their client that they should take a guilty plea, that that's perhaps not in the client's best interests?
I don't think anything changes in terms of the defence solicitor's duties to the court and their the Law Society rules about the way that they deliver the service. So I wouldn't have expected that to make any difference. And I think that the key around a lot of this seems to be that this is the appropriateness of the settlement. The Crown won't be taking, I wouldn't have thought, any different settlements that they wouldn't have otherwise taken. So it shouldn't necessarily make any change in my understanding of what will happen. It will just happen at an earlier stage without the need for others being involved where they don't need to be.
I think the other thing, just to be clear for the committee, is that this approach really does reflect what the legal profession have advised the Scottish Government, that fees should be better targeted to that the preparation of cases to aid that early resolution. So it is something that I think will support better cash flow and capacity for defence agents as well.
One last point. The nature of the crimes this would cover are obviously summary, but that can include acts of violence and so on. And victims often complain that the system, the process, is quite opaque. They're not kept in the loop. They're not told of disposals. They're often left in limbo for significant periods of time. I just wonder if there's been any consideration given to inform them of disposals as part of this change, because it seems there's even less chance of being told if there's not going to be the formal hearing that is going to now be not needed.
Yeah, I mean, this would be the, as I understand it, this would relate to pleading diets, and so I'm not, I wouldn't always expect victims, witnesses to be there. But the communication of the process of what happens, there's initiatives underway, as I understand it, in the Crown to address that lack of transparency. And that I suppose, is where I would expect those issues to be picked up. What we do in relation to these regulations is simply to remove the barrier in terms of legal aid. The wider initiative that SCTS are undertaking, those seem to be quite relevant points in relation to, if you're going to have those efficiencies, how you communicate what has happened in a case, but those things, I think, that would seem the natural place for those things to be picked up.
I understand this is business of the court and the Crown, but I wonder if it could even be a stipulation that you make it a requirement that as this has progressed, there's a need to inform victims and witnesses. Otherwise, there's a real risk, I think, that they'll be left not knowing the outcome of cases. And if you've been a victim of violence in particular or some other crime of that nature, it seems only right that that should be front and centre of any such change.
Yeah, I think, as Martin said, I think there are, as the committee will know, a number of initiatives in this area to... I think we're all clear that better communication is beneficial. So I'm sure that is something that will be looked at by the Crown and by SCTS in that work that they're taking forward on that issue.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Fulton, would you like to come in?
thanks, Convener, and welcome to the Minister and your colleagues. I just wanted to put on the record that I'm very supportive of this. I mean, this, I think, as Russell Finlay said there, the churn within the court systems has been a massive issue. It was a massive issue for the last Criminal Justice Committee in the previous session, and I imagine probably before then. So we should really be welcoming any sort of steps to address this, and I think it's really good that the Minister's recognised that and bringing forward something that has the potential. So that takes me on to my question, Minister. I wonder if I know it's obviously a pilot and you'll review it, but if you get any sort of early indications, any early assessments of what impact this might make on both the COVID and the longer term backlogs. And if you don't have numbers, that's okay. I know that Kate Clark's already asked for an update in due course, but is there any sort of early assessments of what it might mean in terms of numbers?
No, we don't have any data of that type at the moment, but I'm quite confident that I think this will have a significant impact on resolving cases appropriately at an earlier stage, which, for all the reasons we've discussed, I think will be beneficial across the system.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. If there are no more questions, in that case, I'll invite the Minister to move the motion number 05162 that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the Advice and Assistance Summary Criminal Proceedings Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations of 2022 be approved.
Formally moved.
Thank you very much. So the question is that motion 05162 in the name of Ash Regan be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much indeed. So thank you very much for attending, Minister. And that concludes our consideration of the SSI, and we'll move into private session now, and details of the next committee meeting will be announced in due course in the business bulletin. Thank you very much.